Welcome.
Hello there. So, Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back. I am going from the very, very, very beginning. A long time ago. A long, long time ago. So, here we go. This is the fanfare, Alfred Newman's fanfare. Not sure who orchestrated it. Maybe he did it himself. And then we're straight into the main title of Star Wars as well. So, really excited about that, to have a look at it. And I've tried to dissect it as much as is worthwhile for you all, really. So one of the first things to mention about the fanfare is that, you know, a lot of work's been done on it already. Frank Lehman, of course, has done a whole article on this, so Hollywood Cadences. And one of the main things is this sort of idea. But it's slightly different. So, I mean, he says, with its blend of bittersweet melodrama and intimations of the transcendent, this cadential idea possessed connotations, romantic sentiment that were well worn even in the 1930s, at a sound that would have struck 1953 audiences as a throwback, as it does today. Newman's gesture is a variant of a more generalised routine, this sort of 6-flat-6-5 cadence, or more simply mixed cadence, MC. In this harmonic formula, the sixth scale degree in major drops directly from its natural to a flattened state prior to the capture of major tonic, the phrase ends. And what's interesting, actually, in some of the research I've done, is that there are lots and lots of different sort of par errors or score errors that seems to have crept in since the 1930s, which is really remarkable. And it's quite difficult to actually transcribe them. So even on using transcribe, where you can plug in your audio file, slow it down to half speed, etc., quarter speed even, it's not conclusive, because a lot of the notes are kind of not quite in tune. And so sometimes there's, you know, you're not quite sure what's happening. I think the first bit's okay. It's definitely an A diminished, half diminished. Diminished. Fully diminished. Sort of oscillates between B flat. And then we've got this sort of G minor 7 with an F, and then F7, and then B flat. Da-da-da-bum. Ba-da-da-dum. So that's a lovely turn. Ba-ba-ba-bum. And is this a natural? I've seen it written as an A flat, but that doesn't really make any sense at all. And I've seen it with examples of an A flat and an A natural, like that, in a score, which just doesn't work at all. So I'm pretty sure it has to be. It's still quite spicy because of this G minor chord. Why have I written G major? That's very strange. You know, that's also important. Let's just make it really clear. Just, I know there's a B flat already there, but anyway, it just makes it a little bit more succinct. But it's interesting, that sort of cadence. I mean, interesting enough, I was just listening to Schumann's Toccata, played by an extraordinarily good pianist in the 1980s, I think, or even 90s. But anyway, that's by the by. The cadence that Schumann comes up with. Can't quite play that. So another sort of variant. But of course, it's a plagal ending. F to C. Whereas this is a perfect cadence ending. So there's a slight difference, really. And that is one of the things that Frank points out in his article about this plagal ending and a perfect cadence ending. Yeah, really interesting, and it's iconic, and it makes you sort of sit up and you sort of think, oh, something exciting is about to happen. And I love that move. So we got a sort of 5, flat 5, 4, kind of, if you were sort of doing it on the keynote of C, otherwise it's just chromatic notes, basically, depending on whatever key you're in. And in B flat it would be 6, flat 6, 5, so it corresponds to what Frank says in his article. Anyway, but interesting that seem to be lots of sort of errors that have crept in through the whole thing. So anyway, all of it's notated. I've got the sort of field drums, snare drums, bass drum cymbals, that's basically it, timpani as well, and then a sort of simple crash at the end with a snare drum and a timp roll. A nice sort of balanced approach to the chords. So here, horns and trombones are sort of basically in unison. Interestingly enough, the F here is actually at the top of the structure. So we've got those on the trombones and those on the horns. And then we've got just G minor in the trumpets, which generally tend to take more of the triadic role. So they're not going to play the dissonant notes, they'll just play the upper extensions of them, all in root position. Then it's slightly different again. We've got the extensions within the main body of suff and other things which are prominent. Actually, we do have an extension which is the top or in the middle voice at this point, so that's the seventh I'm talking about. And then, so when the melody goes up to the B flat, then we've got like that's in there. In the trumpets and horns, so that's, this is trumpets, that's horns, this is trombones. And you can see the nice sort of balance tends to be sort of a little bit of a gap between voice 1 and 2 and a little bit of a gap between voice 4 and 3. And then it leaps down like that. So, interesting. So, and here there's no F in the trombones as well. So it's there are little sort of orchestration points which are sort of worth just thinking about and how it's dealt. You know, we got sort of closed position here, then we got slightly more open position, and then closed position, I guess, in the trombones at least, the top trombones, the tuba and bass trombone are just playing in octaves at that point. So there is a bit of variety, and also in terms of its openness when it comes into the C minor, we've got horns doing sort of slightly different notes. It's just the bare fifth like that, and it just closes in. Really interesting. It gives you a sort of insight into that sort of you know, stuff done a little bit later on. I'm trying to remember when Newman actually did that CinemaScope thing. I'm sure it's in here somewhere. 1953 extended the Fanfare. So it was definitely in the minds of people when they went to see Star Wars, you know, 20 odd years later or whatever. And then suddenly we're into the main title as well. So there's a very, very good article by Alex Ross, the New Yorker, who talks about it. So I'll put a link on here. I don't think you can actually click onto it, but I'll make sure it's in the YouTube descriptor. And he just talks about John Williams' style, really, because, of course, there's so much information about it. So I'm not going to sort of try not to repeat things that other people have said. But it did get me wondering about not just the heroics of the main theme, although we will discuss that, but actually I was really interested in all of this Quartal harmony stuff, which happens right at the beginning. Like that. So this is a sort of four-note seed Quartal chord, which is partly why people have sort of likened it to Holst, Jupiter, set 423, by the way, and, you know, the sort of King's Row thing. But, you know, it's vastly different from King's Row. Yes, it's got... but it's not. It's just used as an open fifth. It's very different. And also it has an enormous amount of internal repetition as well. But let's deal with the Fanfare first, because it's intensely interesting. First of all, I've actually done a separate thing here. So I'll put this up in YouTube, I think, for not just patrons. I think it's for all, this one, because it's such a sort of iconic thing. So different ideas. I was just sort of mulling this over, and I might be getting a bit too cerebral sort of thing here, but I love the fact that this X and Y right at the beginning, that we've got here, the trombones and the horns, and they're doing slightly different rhythms. They're kind of rhythms in opposition in some ways. In this case, we've got a long note, which then decreases to shorter note values, and then even shorter ones, and the natural conclusion would be that that would eventually become four semiquavers, then a, you know, a quintuplet, and then eventually you might get into the demi-semiquavers, so 32nd notes at that point. So it's a progressive thing, which is kind of ever-decreasing rhythms. This bit here is kind of doing the opposite, because we've got this pattern here, which is the triplet version of that. Then we've got another diminution here, or actually augmentation. And the natural implication is that then it would go backwards into, let's call this X, and let's call what I've just talked about Y. So X is a progressive decrease in note duration. So in other words, smaller note values, faster. Y is a progressive increase in note duration. So I don't know whether I'm reading too much into it, but I'd like the fact that they're, you know, it's not just rhythmic counterpoint. Obviously, it's difficult to hear when it's just the same note, literally the same pitch. Bom, dim, digga, digga, dim, bum, ba, ba, digga, digga. You know, and that is a sort of quite an advanced polyrhythmic effect if we have just that beat as well, because this comes in between da, di, ba, ba. the deep ba is on the ba, ba ba, ba 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 ba. So it's complicated, very complicated. And then we've got the next main bit. So we've got the actual fanfare, which is this what I've highlighted in yellow here, and it's in canon at the octave, and it's after two eighth notes as well. So here we start off just this. And here we've got the exact same thing, but an octave higher. So this is just treating these two separately. And it fits in very beautifully, but it's extremely complex if we think about it. And also, don't forget that we've also got all the horns and then the trumpets that are coming in with slightly different notes. And also, you know, they're with the horns or with the trumpets at that bit, but in opposition to the trombones at that bit as well. It's an interesting sort of interplay. And if you go into lots of sort of fanfare stuff, most of them are very homophonic. They're not sort of cascading. And it's quite hard to find any that are, actually, with these sort of canonic entries. But I'm sure you will find some. I just gave up after a while because I didn't have time to research it. You know, I'm sure other people will find it. Anyway, the next thing is that it's all basically based on these perfect fourths. And then eventually you get the high A flat there as well. Whoops, shouldn't have done that. So we have this sort of seed quartal chord. Again, it's a sort of... you know, that sort of Jupiter Holst type sort of thing. It's not like it's just a quartal thing, but it's in the memory at least. But I wonder what came first. I wonder whether the main theme actually came first and then Williams built the fanfare around it, or maybe the fanfare came first and he built the theme around that. Who knows? Both of them are very much to do with this perfect fourth, but also this seventh as well, because that's also significant as well. So we also have two versions of this, which share notes, and they all sort of coalesce into each other eventually. So I've shown how, you know, this sort of bit is kind of there, and also there, of course, in this. And then here we've kind of got a mixture of the two, actually, because you've got the A flat as well. So it's not quite like this, but I've kind of sort of delineated it a little bit. So we have a quartal chord. Some people might call it a B flat quartal. You could call it an F quartal as well. And we've also got a B flat pedal all the way through this bit here. So to go into even more detail, yes, we've got perfect fourth between those notes and those notes. Sorry, the B flat and the E flat, and we've also got another perfect fourth between the B flat and the F as well. We've also got that major seventh. Now that becomes important, even more important. I think something has... that's right. It should just be there, I think. When we also see the relationship between these intervals in the fanfare and the actual theme. But I'll talk about that a little bit later. Here we've just got we've got three layers of counterpoint, excluding the pedal B flat. So we've got the trombones, we've got the horns, we've got the trumpets, but let's not forget the horns. They sort of complete the sort of oral resonance, I guess, of this. So we've got in canon, and then we've got a slightly different bits of counterpoint here, which basically introduce the A flat, which we haven't really seen up until that point. So careful avoidance of A flat with B flat as major second. Yeah, it's interesting. You know, here that's a seventh away, We do have one note there, but actually we have a seventh there. And here we've only got one instance of that major second, otherwise it's a major seventh. Or ninth, of course. So there's a definite control over this as well. So which I find really interesting. So that kind of hopefully covers everything, I think. I've talked about this sort of X and Y with this sort of diminution thing. Anything in red refers to this initial four note digga digga sort of thing. The tuplet as well is derived from that X in terms of rhythm. And of course that comes from the canonic entry as well. That tuplet also gives rise to the whole nature of the theme in the first place. So that's kind of that whole bit. I did find some interesting material in an article which was called The Curious Afterlife of Dissonant Counterpoint, Jeanette Holland's Class Notes from Henry Cowell's 1951 Advanced Music Theory course, which is extraordinary, actually. it's really remarkable. It's basically an exercise book of Cowell's lecture notes and how he devised dissonant counterpoint. He says there's method in it. I think the method is basically avoiding any sense of tonality as well. It's a sort of almost going into an atonal territory. And I'm not quite sure that, you know, what relevance that necessarily has to Williams, but I was trying to find something on quartal chords, and of course Henry Cowell was known for those sorts of types of resonances. So it led me down a little bit of a rabbit hole, but it's well worth having a look at. Of course, you've got things like Bartok. There's a piece based on fourths in Microcosmos, and also Allegro Barbara, I think, as well, which is all based on sort of quartal harmony. There's Mathis de Mahler, Hindemith, all sorts of different things. But there's very little, although it's quite prominent, about quartal harmony, unless it's sort of Copland and tends to be in things like Appalachian Spring or other things like that, other bits of his film music as well, something to do with the West or how the West was won or something like that. I'm sure you'll find them, but they do tend to have that sort of connotation of Americana, definitely. And also the fourth tends to be, you know, quite heroic as well. So, you know, we've also got that going on too. A small amount of filigree going on, which is an interesting one. With that sort of flat six idea as well. I probably wouldn't have done that. I probably would have written a D natural. And it's strange how sometimes Williams always does the unexpected. And, you know, even the theme itself has an extraordinarily complex rhythmic counterpoint to it, which took me years to try and understand. And I still can't quite keep up with it. You know, by memory, I have to look at a score to sort of follow it on the page to work out what's going on. So that brings us on to the main theme. So let's just talk about the melody to start off with and how it's structured, because it's really interesting. Like a lot of Williams, there's a symmetrical design to it, which I find really appealing. So, for example, we've got this upward fifth, which is then inverted, or a tonal inversion, with the opposite notes going back as a perfect fourth. So that is the inversion of a fifth anyway. And also we've got a nice design of going all the way up to B flat and then continuing up there. And then it changes to a C, because of course it's not going back to the tonic, it's going to the dominant at that point. But those notes are interesting because they kind of highlight you know, the whole sort of progression of what's going on, which is which is interesting. So we've also got the rhythmic tuplet figure, and we've also got this minor seventh. Now, hold a sec. There's something interesting going on here. If we have a look at the whole fanfare, where we've got this approach, we've got that sort of minor seventh, which is found here. And also we've got this sort of descending fourth as well, like this. Obviously a different key at that point. But if you look at how it's constructed, we've got that F, which then goes perfect fourth, and then back down. Sorry, minor seventh, and then back down, perfect fourth. And then, of course, repeats. And then sort of fills up the melodic space between... there, between that ambit, I suppose is a good word to use. In other words, the notes are filled in, which is remarkable and also quite classic as well. Let's have another look at how classical this is. You know, we've got sort of first subject, second subject, kind of development, and then not quite recapitulation, but it does happen again. So that could be our recapitulation. There's a sort of sonata form aspect going on with this. But we've got A, that's the fifth. We've got the tuplet and the seventh, which is B. A1 is an inversion of that. And also, don't forget, it's half the time. Then we've also got B again, because that's repeated. And we've got A1 again. And then we've got B1, because that is now, instead of going up to a minor seventh, we're going down a minor third, but the tuplet remains. And then there's a recessional quality, because we've got some beats at the end. It has an interesting structure. That's just the melody. Of course, once we then... So that's that. Then also we've got this rhythmic counterpoint, which is remarkable. I mean, it's very complex rhythmically. Let's try and put in a proper thing here so it works. Let's do that. Copy that over. And hopefully paste it there. There we go. That's interesting, isn't it? let's just do it again. It's just going to be minim equals something, isn't it? What is it? 100. Let's just do that. So that should now play. Let's just do that. And we'll do that second part a little bit later. But that is an extraordinary complex rhythmic counterpoint to it. So we've retained the tuplet figure in the bass. That's a sort of a Beethoven fifth type technique. And then we're using off beats as well, because otherwise it's too plodding. You know, otherwise if it's off the beat, it's much more energetic. And then it gives us added impetus and momentum to keep us into this bar here. Dum ba dum bum bum bum. That repeats. And of course, there's a slight change, but pretty much the same. And then nothing. So actually, it comes in on the weak part of the bar, but beat three. And then we've got all of this sort of filigree. Like that, which I think I talk about actually a little bit later on. Not there. Oh, yeah, no, I do. So it's just sort of F major scale degrees with chromatic auxiliary and passing notes, and then it's modified to mixolydian with the E flat at the end. But back to this for the time being. So, extraordinarily complex rhythmic counterpoint, which is then modified even further harmonically. So, at this point, we've got B-flat. So, we've got a B-flat with an A in the bass. And it goes back to the B-flat, then back to the A. And then we've also got this sort of E-flat add 9 with a G in the bass. Now it changes, so the harmony changes both times as it comes, which is interesting. And then we've got another sort of little imposter here as well. So we've almost got a actually, I would think that's probably better as a B flat major seventh, really. Yeah, in fact, it's got a B flat in it anyway. It's just not always present. So sometimes the A is not found in the strings. In this particular example. I'll talk about what the numbers mean in a minute. So the harmonies is very different, and it has this... it's a sort of rather Walton, sort of Elgar sort of thing. And here we've got a slight change where the bass is included, whereas it wasn't before, because it comes in halfway through. So there's all sorts of different things going on at this point, because of course the bass notes change, as do the chords. So a really extraordinary, bit of musical writing at that point. And again, it took me years to sort of, you know, understand what on earth is going on in it, because there's so much else that's going on. And I've done a sort of not quite a reduction, but the sort of thing that you might have sketched and just gone, we'll just repeat that in, that's all repeated in the strings. But it's not quite. There are sort of little subtle changes sometimes. So depending on how many notes you've got, basically. But it's interesting how it changes here to that, whereas that it just retains all the added notes that you actually need for that sort of F minor 7 sus 4. Basically Quartal chord, which dominates the whole thing. What else is going on? Well, we got the B-flat pedal notes, which are now sort of high. I don't like this new version of Sibelius. There's a lot of weird stuff going on. For example, if you go just like that and just do that, oh, suddenly you can write it. So I was doing that before, and it wouldn't do it. You know, you could sort of put it somewhere, and it just wouldn't go. But now it's sort of decided to work suddenly as I'm trying to sort of do it at this point. But I was trying to do, you know, if you... Okay, fine. That was weird. So it's temperamental. Anyway, another reason for eventually moving to Dorico. We've got this going on. Why is that a B-sharp? That's very strange. So all of these sort of trills, and they're basically just sort of highlighting chord tones that are all over the place. So that's Celeste, the violins are playing the top note, and then we've got woodwind sort of oscillating and trilling between different notes of the chord. And you know, some very slight changes. So on the time that it happens the first time around, just notice that little sus 4. So we've got it just changes just really subtly. Like that. Whereas in fact the harp is just doing the B flats, a B flat sus4, because it will still work. So I love that. That little small adjustment. And then we've got the sort of iconic bit at that point as well. It's probably because there's just too much information on here. Then I've got sort of F mixolydian, which I think I've just talked about. Then we've got this new accompaniment figure as the theme returns the second time when it's harmonized with the bass. New accompaniment figure, repeated B flat with low auxiliary note A. See the symphony number 10, Allegro. For ultimate filigree, though, woodwind runs and short note symphony number 13, Shostakovich, about 11 minutes 13 into the first movement. It's just filled with this sort of stuff. Not always on a pedal note, necessarily, but that sort of idea is quite a sort of common classical symphonic expression. So, we've talked about how that changes, and I've done all the different sort of chordal things for that. It's a bit more... even the rhythmic counterpoint is different at that point. So here, but dum da ba 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 bum ba dum bum ba ba. Here, bum ba dee da 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 dum bum ba 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 bum. It's a bit more regular. It's a bit less offbeat. Basically, because the bass has to have more of a sort of tonal melody at that point, rather than just sort of chord function bass note. Okay, so that sort of seems to have gone up there. There we go. So then we're on to the main theme B section. So at this point, we're back into our sort of E flat F. Not back into it, we haven't heard it yet. but we're in that. So an interesting orchestration point, not the E flat or note, it should say, note the E flat first inversion above the F pedal. So this is what I'm referring to in the horns. And then it's treated as such with oboes. Don't repeat the G for good sonority. And also because we've got the G in the melody. In other words, the oboes are playing fourths. Now, you know, if you ever studied Rimsky-Korsakov's orchestration book, you'd know that he generally tends not to go for dissonances, which a fourth is, in his sonority. So it's interesting that oboes and the horns at this point are kind of doing all the harmonic work. But I think it's perfectly acceptable, especially when it's a first inversion. And in fact, it's really a third inversion if you include the F. But if we didn't include the F, it'd be a first inversion. You don't really want to repeat the G there, just because it's not the greatest of intonation or sonority at that point. So a small point, but one that I thought I'd make. We've also got the retention of that minor seventh, but at this time harmonically rather than melodically. And then we've got that sort of perfect fourth. So there's still some elements from the main theme in the A section retained in the B section. And really, it's just a pedal note all the way through. And then it changes. I don't know why that was not in red, but it is now. And again, we just sort of got chord tones on this point as well. So we've got piano and then harp at this point as well. Sorry, we've got celeste and then harp, and then that is piano at that point. And that's harp. I hate how you can't sort of just simply double click on it. It's really, really annoying. These stupid handles, which I don't think I've ever used, ever. And then this sort of lovely... chord. It's remarkable. So Yeah. You know, people sort of call it flat seven, but that's only if you think you're in E. Well, you're kind of in E flat. But it's difficult because we're sort of still sort of in B flat. That would, I guess, be a sort of dominant. So it's really chord flat three, really? Or is it flat six? I think if you're in B flat, it becomes flat three. So, I don't know. I mean, people sort of call it flat seven, but actually it's kind of flat three if you're in B flat. If you're in B flat, are we? I don't know. It's that F at the bass that's bothering me. I think we're in F. Well, we're in B flat, but it's sort of the dominant of B flat. That's the feeling. Anyway. And now all the change occurs. So we've got sort of lots of little things at the end here. So after this sort of movement, D flat to F movement, just here, you can kind of see it in the piano part. At that point, it just gives it another little bit of momentum. And then we've got this beautiful counter melody. Which works incredibly well. So I'll just play the strings bit. It just does this. Very, very simple when it's got all the whole chordal function here. And actually, it's a little bit, it's more deceptive than you might think. So we've got sort of basically just passing notes here. And a very strong passing note here. Kind of on A flat, but we've got this sort of sharp nine, sort of like an upwardly resolving suspension to there, to the C. So it just gives a little bit of sort of chromatic nuance, really. And then we've got sort of A flat add to. Yeah, so it's actually a lot more sort of spicy. Because of the suspended chord after it as well. It's the addition of this B flat in the A flat chord. And of course it's part of the melody anyway. Now we've got a divergent progression. Worth bearing in mind that we've also got so like a sort of mixolydian mode. With a little passing note, or sorry, a little lower chromatic auxiliary note at that point. But we're basically on F. It's just a mixolydian F, which does happen quite a lot as well. In other words, the E flat is sort of an E natural. But I suppose that is in keeping with the, like that, that sort of suspended chord, or rather the E flat with the F in the bass. And then we've got this amazing conversion. It's a strange sort of sense of lack of fifth, or rather lack of third on the very last bit here. On this chord, that sort of B flat, this one, the B flat one, or the A flat with the B flat. I don't know why I put A flat 5. It's not. It's without the fifth. It's without the E flat. So we just have that. There's none of that. I mean, I guess it's always implied because, you know, if A flat is the sort of root note of the main sort of upper extension, at least, regardless of the bass, then you would expect to hear an E flat because the A flat is sounding acoustically. So there's no need. And also it then keeps it in line with the voice leading in thirds as well. Otherwise, it sort of destroys it. We've also got this sort of B flat, which goes all the way through. So that sort of further complicates things slightly, sonority wise. So it's still sort of a B flat pedal at that point, a sort of tonic pedal. And it eventually wants to go to an A, which it kind of does, almost, except it doesn't quite, because we still have this sort of F7 sus 4. So the B flat never quite gets to an A; it never quite resolves, which is a way of him sort of keeping momentum going on. So what notes do we actually have? Sort of G flat, sort of half diminished. And then D diminished, E flat minor. This is an odd one. Actually, I'm going to change my mind. That's kind of B flat minor, really. Because of the B flat here. So C half diminished. It sort of really converges. And then wonderful sort of half diminished to that F7 sus 4, that move here. Like that. Really, really interesting. So very harmonically rich. Also all block chordal harmonization, but with a B flat pedal going on. Then we've got our sort of usual chord that we've had before. Then we've got our bit there, which we bring out. Notice that little bit of 16th callback to the fanfare that we had. Then we got a little Dorian mode, which becomes B flat major. Absolutely remarkable. And then we've got sort of lovely little filigree going on. So let's just talk about that. So because of the chords here, we've got another accompaniment. So the you know, again, the bass line has changed. Let's just play that just simply. Then it's harmonized again, which is similar as before. What's going on with this though is that we got little scale degrees in B flat. Well, that's not surprising because it's a B flat. Then the scale degrees on F because the melody is F, even though we're still in B flat. But all of those notes are part of F major. Then we got scale degrees of E flat. There's an E flat. And it keeps going on all the way. Notice that A flat. But also we're in this chord here, which harmonizes with that E flat and also the B flat and also, I guess, the C as well, which actually happens later on. you know, a little bit later on. Then we've got scale degrees of F melodic minor. Well, yep, we've got F minor 7, so that makes sense. We've got scale degrees of B flat. There's a B flat going on here. Then scale degrees of E flat. There's an E flat. And that keeps going. And then we've got scale degrees of B major with some chromatic passing note. Up to that non-harmonize bit that we have at that point. And notice that it never gets to like that, because it's still got to keep going. Then we have the figure that we had before, the filigree, in block chordal harmonization, with the in root position at this point. So again, the same sort of theme. Let's try and just do that with different bass notes. A sort of, it's strange hearing it on the piano, isn't it? So very slight changes. You know, that bass line. And also, it just changes to an E flat chord. Like that. And then we've got this sort of rather strange sort of F add 4. And we've got this sort of weird false relation at that point, which is remarkable, and it doesn't really come out on the recording. You kind of can. You sense there's something slightly wry, but with everything going on, it just doesn't sound like a false relation at all. Then we've got this triplet, the sort of coda after the main theme. And it's all quarterly based, so it just sort of builds up, as I've said. And then changes bass note, really, to B-flat 7 sus 4. So it's the same chord, it's just got a B-flat in the bass at that point. So it just changes slightly. And then we've got, our A-flat with B-flat in the bass. And filigree now. And suddenly, we're into Starry Night at this point. And then we're back into Imperial Probe Droid. Amazing. So the Starry Night, I've talked about it quite a few times on this channel. So, we got sort of C above D flat at that point. So all the D flat notes are in the bass. All the C notes are in the top. And you can sort of see that here. Sometimes there's a sort of mixture here. So we sort of actually got the impression of a C augmented at that point, kind of, because of the presence of the A flat just what there in that register. Otherwise, everything else is sort of lower. So it's not necessarily as simple as just going C over D flat, because you could kind of say that it's actually, well, it's sort of C augmented as well. And also, there's no G in any of the woodwind parts. That only exists in the string parts, which is another sort of further complication. So nothing is as ever simple as you sort of think about it, because the orchestration makes it less simple. You know, C exists there, but that's C augmented. So you could say, well, you got C and C augmented. So our usual 419B friend, major chord with the flat 6. And then D. Like that. So it's kind of a chord complex which is derived from the Hungarian minor. Then we've got 532, which is this chord here. Notice the lack of G
again, in
any of the woodwind or brass parts, all of that is either A major or C dyad. So just those two notes. The G is only present in the strings. So another sort of bitonal chord that we've got there. And then it changes to E augmented. Could be written as a G sharp. Yeah, so again, no... Oh, we do have a G now. In fact, quite prominently. And that's where we get our little sort of major seventh, which comes in, you know, in all the films. Very much sort of a Star Warsian thing, that major seventh, which leads to 3-3, which leads to all sorts of other chords, which he gains from that seed dyad, really. And then we've got our usual major chord with a flat six, lovely C with a flat six. I mean, you could write it like that, but you know, that's just another way of doing it, where you have a augmented chord with a major seventh as well. It's the same thing, really. It's just another inversion. So that is it, folks. So that brings us into Imperial Prodroid, which I've already done. So I now need to backtrack and find out where I am. It's a bit strange to sort of delving into this, isn't it? Sort of backwards, but there we go. So I'm going to make this available because I think it's the right thing to do, really. Like Finn. I will do that. And then you can sort of, you know, have a go and muck around and play with it and sort of change all the notes and things. But I think there are two things. First of all, there's the melodic construction, which is fascinating, and the symmetry about it. There's also the rhythmic counterpoint that goes with it, and then the use of these quartal chords as well, which is all the way through. And the last thing probably is the harmonization that goes with it, which is really, really remarkable. It's so good. You know, very few composers are that good at doing that sort of very on-the-nose type of music in terms of these days. Very difficult to do, I think. So anyway, I hope you've enjoyed it, that little exploration of the main theme. There are lots of other cues to get through with this film, so I've made a good start on it, so I'm kind of racing through. We'll try not to race through, but it's good to get it underway at last. So here we are, and then I'll have a link to the next cue after this one. Thanks for watching.